All right, Dwayne. Good morning. Y'all prepare for homecoming? Here we go, choir, stand up.
Into a wild man, some people said I'd gone crazy. All too soon came the harvest of the wild seeds that I had sown. I stumbled into that meeting, I was looking like death warmed over. And I heard the gospel at the corner of Hardware with a new hope.
Let's open up with prayer this morning. Father, we thank you, God, that we hear the gospel right here in Emmett County. I thank you so much, Lord, for the truth of the word. I thank you, God, for the celebration, Lord, of a homecoming, Father. Father, many years ago, people planted a shovel here and said that the Holy Spirit had led them to come here and begin this church. I pray, Father, in the name of Jesus, that we never cease to understand that we are called to be a lighthouse. No matter what's taking place, no matter what the threats are from whether it's a disease or anything else, God, you remain the same. I pray, Lord, for the anointing to just move in our congregation, Father. And Lord, if there's someone who sits here who does not know you in a personal way, I pray that today will be the day of salvation. I thank you so much for Brother Digby coming here, Father. I ask his blessing upon him. Lead him, guide him, give him the words to speak. In Jesus' name, amen. As we begin, I want to just take a moment. I want to take care of some of the little regular business we have here. But so I want to read this little letter that was sent to the church. It says, the family of John Russell Melton wanted me to express our gratitude for the kindness of your church extended to us. You went out of your way to make it a special occasion, and it was. I have many friends at Mount Pleasant. I'm making sure I'm getting these words right. A lawyer wrote this. But your whole church went above and beyond to make my family welcome and provide a final resting place for my uncle. Your kindness will never be forgotten. God bless you. And that comes from Brother Reggie Jones on behalf of the family with Russell Melton. So just we thank the Lord for his sacrifice. You know, he was the one who killed at Pearl Harbor, and we had that ceremony just the other day. Also, I want to remember that we have, let's see, go ahead, Leslie, tell me what all we got to get. So the kids, our children, are leaving to go to camp tomorrow, and that's at Garaway. Okay, so you need to be here at about 7:30. They'll be loading up all your things onto the bus, all right? Also, today, you know, a homecoming, we normally take up an offering. So we have a regular offering in that box back there. You don't even see us pass a plate. That's a regular offering right there. But we also take up an offering for our cemetery, and Brother Ellis was going to say something about that.
I just want to say that we appreciate all the donations and the things that people do for our cemeteries, because it's, you know, a lot of times people just look at the cemetery, but we have two of them, and it's a lot of upkeep in that, so we just encourage people that they would donate to the cemetery fund to help us maintain that until Jesus comes, and we just thank everybody for doing that, and there is some pamphlets in the back of the pews there that you can put that in if you have that for the day, and then after the service, we'll just have somebody standing there with the offering plates, and so you can just drop that in there. That would be for the cemetery fund only that would go in that. But we appreciate everybody in that, because as we all know, we're all experiencing everything in our households, that everything keeps going up and keeps going up, and it's the same thing for our cemeteries and the upkeep and that, and we appreciate everybody that gives to that.
Also, we've been making a new directory for the church, and it's going to be, where's the checkout place here for to look at it? So it's going to be in the back where all the food is. So as you're waiting, when you're waiting in line and everything, I want you to remember to check it, make sure your address is right, your phone number is correct, and just look in there if you would. We appreciate Glenda's sacrifice in making this for the church. She's placed it all together, taking the photographs and everything, and we really appreciate what she has done. Today also, we have our special speaker, Brother Kenny Digby, and he loves Emmett County, and he when he was coming here, it had on his GPS that the road was closed. And of course, coming down to Oxford and Eden. And so, praise the Lord. That was a new sign. It wasn't there just the other day. So, just keep him in your prayers. We appreciate him. I've been trying to get him for the last couple of years. He stays pretty booked up. He's with the Christian Action Group at the Mississippi Baptist Convention, and still delivering the message. Praise the Lord. Still going all over. Matter of fact, he had a wedding yesterday he was at, so he's just going all over the place. Is there any other messages, Liz? VBS, and that is, when is it? The 25th through the 29th, we have Vacation Bible School. Get ready. Get excited. It's going to be a great thing. We're going to deliver that message. Remember last year, everything was going fabulous, and when that old dreaded came up and everything. So y'all keep that in prayers. And if you can help, listen, it's not too late. You can help us as we bring that message of Christ to our children. We can't stop. We cannot stop. If you see the signs, do you see the signs? Do you not see revelations being unfolded right here before your very eyes? Please, don't let things intimidate you. Christ is still on the throne. Everything's going to be okay. I ask that you would keep also all our friends and neighbors that are sick. We have some in the hospital, and they'll be on right on back of your bulletin. Keep them on your prayers.
Wasn't that a good song to start off with this morning?
Amen.
Gospel heart on Heartbreak Ridge and New Hope Road, and then we've changed it to Gloucester, Oxford, Beanville Road. I may take a lap before it's over with. But let me get all my stuff together. He just mentioned about what do we see? We see the signs. We see what we got to go. But when it gets down to it, as long as we know Jesus, all we got to do is don't be moved. Everybody stand. I shall not be moved. We're going to go as fast as David and Robbie can go. Here we go. Glory, hallelujah, I shall not be moved. Anchored in Jehovah, I shall not be. Just like a tree that's planted by the water, Lord, I shall not be moved. Well, I shall not be moved. I shall not be. Just like a tree. Stand up. Y'all can't sit down. God is so good. I thank the Lord for this church. I thank the Lord for this choir. As we sing this morning, we've talked about the when we got saved, the corner of Heartbreak Ridge and New Hope Road. But there's only one reason any of us can be saved. That's called the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Because I want you to know, no matter what the world does, no matter what you hear, there's still something about that name. Jesus, the mere mention of his name can calm the storm, heal the broken,
and raise the dead. At the name of Jesus, I've seen sin-hardened men, derelicts, transformed. I've seen light of hope put in the eyes of a hopeless child. At the name of Jesus, hatred and bitterness turn to love and forgiveness. Arguments cease. I've heard a mother softly breathe his name at the bedside of a child delirious from fever and watched as that little boy, the little body, grew quiet and the fevered brow cooled. I've sat at the side of a dying saint, her body racked with pain, who's in her final fleeting seconds summoned her last ounce of ebbing strength just to whisper earth's sweetest name, Jesus, Jesus. Emperors have tried to destroy it. Philosophies have tried to stamp it out. Tyrants have tried to wash it from the face of the earth with the very blood of those who claimed it. Yet it still stands. And there shall be in that final day when every voice that has ever uttered a sound, every voice of Adam's race shall raise in one mighty chorus to proclaim the name of Jesus. For that day every knee shall bow, every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is truly Lord. You see, it was not by mere chance that caused an angel one night, long, long ago, to say to a virgin maiden, yes, his name shall be called Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus. Yes, there's something about that name. Yes, something about that name.
Remain standing. Y'all stand up with us. What's the one thing we're going to have in heaven when we get there? We're going to all be happy. Everybody will be happy over there. There's a happy land of promise, the first words there. Or we may go with that one. Everybody will be happy over there. Here we go. Are y'all ready? There we go. Here we go.
There's a happy land of promise over in the great beyond, where the sailors shall soon the glory share, where the souls of men shall enter and live on forevermore. Everybody will be happy over there. Well, everybody will be happy.
be seated.
I want to welcome Brother Kenny Digby from our Christian Action Group. I'm very excited to hear him. Some of the men here have heard him speak in the Brotherhood, but he has diligently preached for several years, spreading the good news of Jesus Christ. Brother Kenny, if you'll come.
Am I good on my microphone? Yeah. Brother Tyler, thank you. Where are you? Thank you. What a blessing. Brother Blaine, thank you for this wonderful privilege. It's an honor to be at Mount Pleasant, but to be here on homecoming, thank you. I pastored a Mount Pleasant from 76 to 80. So it feels pretty natural being in the pulpit at Mount Pleasant. So I am honored to be with you. This crowd is wonderful, and I know homecoming is a special, special day. I do want to say thank you for allowing me to serve you at the Christian Action Commission. I'm not a lobbyist, but I am the liaison between our 2,100 churches and the governor, lieutenant governor, and our legislature. And I'm grateful for that privilege I have to represent you. Much of what's done at the Capitol has very little to do with anything biblical. But some legislation, we believe that the Bible has something to say about it. And we try to remind those elected officials what the Word of God has to say. We don't win every battle. But God didn't call me to Jackson to be successful. He called me to Jackson to be faithful. So thank you, thank you, thank you. November the 8th, Dr. Parker, Rick Bly, our prayer minister at the Baptist building, Dr. Parker's our head coach, and I, we are calling our state to a day of fasting and prayer, November the 8th. That's the midterm election. We need men and women who have a Bible worldview. And so would you join us November the 8th? Some of you may have never done a day of fasting. And fasting is not subtraction. That's dieting. Fasting is substitution, where you allow your hunger to remind you to pray and remind you to read your Bible. The three of us have prepared a 21-day prayer guide. I wrote 7 days, Dr. Parker wrote 7 days, and Rick Bly wrote 7 days. And those 21 days lead up to November the 8th. It'd be a great thing to use in your family altar. It'd be a great thing to use in your quiet time in the morning. I'm just asking you, at least look at November the 8th, and I believe our nation's worth fasting over. I believe our nation's worth praying over. God is good. I get to serve you just like this morning. I get to serve you at the Capitol. I get to serve you all over the state. This past week, Monday through Friday, we had teenagers from all over Mississippi at Blue Mountain College, our fourth Christian Leadership Institute for teenagers. It's better to light a candle than curse the darkness. We'll do that next July. We'd love to have your granddaughter. We'd love to have your nephew at Blue Mountain next July. Tuesday night, I'll be at Mal Mason Baptist Church in Carroll County doing a one-night revival. Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, I'll be doing a youth camp at Dora Lake Baptist Church. And I reckon a week from right now, I'll be in Lawrence County. So you pray for me. I tell everybody my middle name's available. If my calendar's empty, then I'm available. So thank you, Pastor, and thank you for this wonderful opportunity. There is a host on Fox News, and he closes every program with part of a verse of scripture. And then he throws a football. Who am I talking about? Hannity. What is the portion of scripture he utilizes at the end of every program? Let not your heart be troubled. Turn with me to John chapter 14, verse 1. I hope you will keep your Bible open. We're going to stitch in and out of these verses for the next few moments. Let not your heart be troubled. When you study the Bible, you need to understand the context. Why did Jesus say, "Let not your heart be troubled," to this group of people? It's the apostles. Because they have just eaten the Lord's Supper. He has just told them, "I'm terminal. I'm going to die." And just as you would be grieved and upset if you found out your loved one is terminal, these apostles were very, very disturbed and grief-stricken and upset. And in that context of leaving the upper room and headed to Gethsemane, Jesus says, "Let not your heart be troubled." This is homecoming. It's a wonderful day. You get to see folks maybe once a year. Homecoming. It's also a day you remember loved ones that are not here today. And for some of you, your grief is still fresh. And I'd say to you, as Jesus said to the apostles, let not your hearts be troubled. If you've looked around lately, our world is in a mess. Our nation is in a mess. Our state, with medical marijuana and gambling and alcohol galore, our state is in a mess. I guarantee you, in your individual family, you may be sitting there knowing that a son or daughter is considering a divorce. You may be sitting there knowing that that lump under your left armpit really needs to be examined by a doctor. There's all kind of things that can disturb us and make us fearful and worry us. Some of you, finances. With $5 gas is enough to make anybody worry. Now, I'm simply saying, whatever it is, Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. Three reasons. I want you to look at verse 1. John chapter 14, verse 1. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. Number one, our faith is in God. If our faith is in God, we ain't got nothing to worry about. Now, if your faith is in your savings account, or your faith is in your retirement fund, you might ought to start worrying yesterday. If your sense of security is in your job, you're on thin ice. If your sense of security and peace is in your family, you see, our faith is not in our church. Our faith is not in our denomination. Our faith is in God. So let me ask a couple of questions. Is God all powerful? Yes or no? So he can do anything? Yes or no? He's in control. Nothing's beyond his reach. So y'all agree, God can do anything. Does he love you? Then if God's all powerful and there are no accidents, we're not victims of chance. If God's all-powerful and he loves you, can you trust him? Yes. Come on now. When you worry, when you fret, when you get troubled, you either don't believe he's all-powerful or you don't believe he loves you. Because if he's all-powerful and he loves you, you can trust him. You know what's crazy? We get saved by faith. Amen? And we will trust him for eternity. If you know you're saved, you're not worried about heaven or hell. Right? And so we will trust him with heaven and hell. We will trust him with eternity. And then a little old trivial situation will keep us awake at night, preoccupy our thinking, make us have conversations to ourselves going down the road. And I'm telling you, that don't make a lick of sense, that if you can trust him with your eternity by faith, it looks like to me you ought to be able to trust him with the day-to-day-to-day situation. Number two, let not your heart be troubled. Why? Our faith is in God, not something else. Number two, there will be a test at the end of the service. Number two, look at verse 2. Are you, John 14, verse 2, you still got your Bible open? I get tickled at evangelists, and I was one. They'll say, how many of you brought your Bible? Raise it and let me see it. And then they never use it again the whole service. John 14, verse 2. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. Now, listen to me. Our Father is God. How do you like those apples? Now, we're a little out of his neck of the woods, but Eugene Digby's a legend. No brag, just fact. Eugene Digby was a legend in North Mississippi. Christ for the Crisis, radio, television ministry. I have benefited greatly, greatly from being Eugene Digby's boy. I like nepotism. Nepotism is favoritism because you're kin to somebody. I love nepotism. I was preaching statewide on TV. Biloxi, Jackson, Hattiesburg, Tupelo, Columbus, Meridian. I was preaching statewide on TV every week when I was 18. Why? Because I was Eugene Digby's boy. But did you know there were some things Eugene Digby couldn't do for me? There were limits. As wonderful as it has been to be Eugene Digby's boy, my ministry started on his shoulders. A big part of me doing over 1,600 revivals in my 52 years of preaching Eugene Digby. But are you hearing me? There are things Eugene Digby couldn't do for me. There ain't nothing he can't do for me. Woo! Our Father is God. How's the model prayer start? Our Father, which art in heaven. But my grandchildren call me Poppy. That's my name. All four of them. College, high school, 3 months old. Well, the 3 month old ain't. He's smart. He ain't that smart. Okay. Poppy, the 2 year old. Poppy. When God told you to call him Abba Father, what he's saying there in Aramaic, in Hebrew, he's not saying, Our Father who art in heaven. No. When he said call him Abba Father, he is literally saying to every one of you, call him Poppy. You say, that sounds disrespectful to me. Well, you go ahead calling him Our Poppy. And I'm going to call him Poppy. Are y'all hearing me? I know I'd do nearly anything I could do for those four grandkids, and you would too. He told me to call him Poppy. Twice in the Bible it says, if you, being evil, that means with a sinful nature, selfish, if you, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children and grandchildren, don't you enjoy giving stuff to your children and your grandchildren? He said, if you enjoy doing good things for your children and grandchildren, how much more does your Father in heaven enjoy doing good things for you? Amen. Woo! My faith is in God, not the preacher, not the church, not the job, not the nation. My faith is in God. My Father is God. One more. Go to verse 3. Be amazed what you'd learn if you'd bring a Bible, keep it open, stitch in and out. You say, you trying to aggravate us? Yeah, I'm trying to get you to bring your Bible. Unless you already know everything you need to know about it, but I ain't got my glorified body yet. Okay. John 14, verse 3. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. Okay, you're going to have to figure the last one out by yourself. Number one, your what is in God. Good. Glad you answered. I'd have done the whole thing over again. Y'all think I'm kidding? Number two, starts with the letter L. Your what is God? Your Father. Y'all are good. Now here's number three, and I'm through. Your what starts letter L. Your what is with God? No, your faith's in God. That's number one. Your what is with God? Huh? Say it louder. Because the rest of these folks want to go to lunch. Your future's with God. Isn't that what verse 3 just said? I go to prayer place for you, and if I go in prayer place for you, I'll come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you go. Our future is with God. That ought to take care of everything. Somebody said, I don't want a pie in the sky by and by. I don't want a pie in the sky by. I'll take it. I have buried a 26-year-old wife. I have buried a 17-year-old son. It really doesn't matter what happens here. I've got something better on the other side.
Amen.
You say, you better be careful what you're saying. Bring it on. It doesn't matter what happens here. Bad things happen to good people, and doggone it, good things happen to bad people. That's Habakkuk and Job all rolled into one. Let me tell you something. Whether you're happy or not has nothing. You young people, are you listening to me? Whether or not you're happy has nothing to do with what happens to you. It has to do with how you respond to what happens to you. Let not your heart be troubled. Your faith is in God. Your Father is God. Your future, woo! Your future is with God. Christmas is Emmanuel, God with us. This is the reverse. It's us with God. Now listen to me, and I'm quitting. This sermon that I've been preaching for a few minutes, this sermon only applies to you if you're saved. If you're not saved, you listening to me? If you're not saved, you need to be worried. Are y'all hearing me? This sermon only applies to you. Neighbor. Whether you're a lady, whether you're a man, whether you're a young lady or a young man, this sermon only applies to you if you're saved. And if you're saved, you ain't got nothing to worry about. But if you hadn't been saved, you walked the aisle, got baptized, joined the church, put your best foot forward, turned over a new leaf. Our Baptist churches are full of lost people. And if you hadn't been saved, you need to be worried. This is homecoming. But what I want you to understand, I believe at any moment, literally, I believe at any moment, there's gonna be a home going. Pastor, thank you. What an honor. This is homecoming. Hopefully this sermon's been appropriate. I think you hear this at more funerals than nearly any other passage. Why? It fits. If he said it to comfort the apostles, why not preach it at a funeral to comfort the family, right? But today is a homecoming. But we're fixing to have an invitation. There'd be no better day to get saved than a homecoming. Because I'm telling you, at any moment, that's what imminent means. At any moment, the trumpet's going to sound, the shout's going to break loose, and Jesus is coming. And if he would just holler right now, we'd turn this homecoming into a homegoing. The only problem is you've never been saved. You'd be left behind. And anybody that's heard the gospel this side of the rapture can't get saved during the tribulation. The tribulation is not plan B for a bunch of Baptists. The tribulation is plan A for the Jews. And for those goyim or heathen who've never heard the gospel. But 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 says very clearly, if you've heard the gospel this side of the rapture, and all of y'all have done heard it now, Jesus died for you on the cross, took all your sins to the cross, was buried, and what did he do? He rose third day. He's up at the right hand of God. And boy, would he love to save somebody on homecoming day at Mount Pleasant. Church member, you may have some kin folks here. This is about the only day of the year other than Easter they come. Come on now. Might be a good day, Grandma, for you to get in the altar and pray that granddaughter today and get saved. Oh, she's sweet little girl, Brother Kenny. She either gets saved or she goes to hell. There'd be something just homecoming at Mount Pleasant. has turned into a revival. Every head bowed. Don't need a pianist. Don't need an organist. I just need Brother Blaine in the altar. You're not concerned enough about your salvation to get up out of your seat and come to this pastor. You ain't going to get saved. You may never get saved. If you're heartbroken over a loved one that's passed away, and you're still maybe a little bit mad at God. Come on now. I live in the real world. You might ought to come on up here and pray with Brother Blaine. If you've got a loved one that would be left behind if Jesus came this afternoon, that'd be a good time to come on up here and get in this altar and pray. If you need to rededicate your life, when would be a better time than homecoming? You may be a visitor today. Why don't you rededicate your life and then go on back home, find you a church and plug in. You understand? This ain't a revival, it could be. And we need about a week, but God only needs one service. Any spiritual need in this building can be met right now. I've got 11:31. We've got time for you to get saved. We've got time for you to get right. So I'm going to sing the invitation, and I'm asking anybody that's convicted, concerned, burdened, I'm asking you to get up out of your seat. If you need to talk with your pastor and pray with your pastor, he's available. If you just need to come kneel in this altar or kneel on this front pew, pray for our nation. Pray for revival. Pray for a lost loved one. Pray for a lost neighbor. Or maybe wouldn't it be something, Brother Blaine, if somebody surrendered to preach today? So I'm going to sing the invitation. You're going to sit there and pray. But I'm hoping somebody is convicted enough, concerned enough. Where are you going to spend eternity? No better day than today to get saved. Come on, right now. Get up out of your seat. Come on to your pastor. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Now listen, all of you, I don't need you singing, I need you praying. And some of you ought to be down here talking to this pastor. Some of you ought to join these others down here in this altar. Don't need you singing, I need you praying. Who's next? Get up out of your seat, come to this altar. Present yourself as a candidate for a baptism. Surrender to preach. Move your letter. Or just come pray with Brother Blaine. Right now. Who's next? Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. Though none go with me, still I will follow. No turning back, No turning back. Gonna do one more verse. If it wasn't for these folks in the altar, we'd already be through. But you get in a mercy verse thanks to them and them praying. I want to tell you, the Spirit's been here this morning. You can walk out of here lost. I fear. Will you ever get saved?